I request Satya Nisrani to introduce our guest speaker, Ms. Snehal Pradhan.
Thank you, Shani. With pleasure. Ms. Snehal Pradhan has represented the Indian cricket team between 2008 to 2011. She is an award-winning sports writer, multilingual cricket commentator, and also a YouTube creator with more than 2.5 lakh subscribers. She is a columnist with Hindustan Times. Her writing has been featured in publications such as ESPN Crick Info, The Economic Times, First Post, Wisden, Wisden India, Verb Magazine, and the likes. She won the silver medal at the SEAT Cricket Awards in 2019 for Best Cricket Writer. And one of her articles has also been recognized by AIPS in the Best Columns in Asia category in 2021. She is the co-author of the Equal Hue Report, a first ever research paper analyzing the state of women's cricket in India. She is a founding member of the Equal Hue Project, which aims to chart the way forward for women's cricket in India. I now request Ms. Snehal Pradhan to address us, and she will initially talk to us about the Equal Hue Project, and thereafter we'll have a Q&A with her.
Thank you, Satyan. Thanks so much for that lovely introduction. Like Satyan mentioned, I'm going to be focusing today's conversation a little bit on the Equal Hue Project, and I'd like to give you some background as to how that really came about. If all of you, I'm sure all of you follow cricket at some level or the other, and I'm sure you remember the 2017 Women's World Cup, where India reached the final of the Women's World Cup at Lord's and got very close to winning the trophy, came within 9 runs, but then fell agonizingly short. And yet the team came back to a hero's welcome. That tournament really helped capture the imagination of the public. The knock in the semi-final, where Harmanpreet Kaur hit 171 not out against Australia to knock the defending champions out of the World Cup, is probably the greatest knock in women's ODI history. And since then, women's cricket has just had its own very strong identity and been on a strong upward climb. At the same time, as someone who's been very keenly involved in women's cricket, I was an active player until 2015. In 2015, I retired looking to pursue other avenues, and there was a desire to increase the amount of focus and the amount of publicity that the women's cricket team was getting, and therefore I chose the field of journalism. I chose the field of media work, and pre-2017 I was one of the very few voices in India who was constantly shining the light on women's cricket, and I'm happy to say that that is a role that I no longer need to do, because women's cricket is very much in the spotlight at present. So as someone who cared so deeply about the ecosystem, who had almost, you know, was almost an instance of how you can play for the country, but how do you help the country win a World Cup as a player? And then asking myself that question as someone in the media, there were a few things that were glaringly obvious that an organization needed to do. Like, I'm sure, for example, if I take an example of the kind of projects that and the Rotary Club takes up. If you want to effect social change, if you want to drive positive results in any kind of community, you need to start with the grassroots. You need to make sure that any project that is being implemented has an impact at the very base level, and then those effects are seen at the top. Similarly, I could see that in women's cricket, the BCCI, despite being the richest cricket body in the world, did not have an under 16 women's age group competition. Similarly, although there was a competition for the boys, so what was happening is there was an under 16 competition for the boys, and on the back of that, your boys under 19 team is consistently winning World Cups. Under 19 World Cup has been won by India for the last 3 occasions, except in 2020. And there is no under 16 competition for the girls. So those kind of glaringly obvious holes existed in our system, despite which our women's team was outperforming and reaching the final and getting the kind of performances that really capture the attention of the nation. So that 2017 World Cup final was, of course, painful for a lot of us. I personally was in the press box for that final. I was one of the three Indian media persons who was traveling from India to cover that tournament. And once again, just shine a light on the Indian team when very few others were writing about them and talking about them. And after that tournament, a few, my colleagues and me, the ones who were there in England, traveling so deeply committed and invested in the game, we asked ourselves, what can we do from the outside? So as a very basic starting point, we decided to draw up a list of our recommendations based on our experience as for me as a player and someone who's covered the game. And my co-authors in this report, I started this project with Siddhant Patnaik, and I finished this project with Karunya Keshav. Both of them together are the co-authors of a fantastic book, which I highly recommend that all of you read. It's called The Fire Burns Blue, which is a history of women's cricket in India. And it has very probably strong ties to the Mumbai scene where things really started for women's cricket, started by very active and industrious women at, I think it was called at the time, the Parsi Cricket Club, which, and of course we know Diana Adelji has to be one of the pioneers of that project. So Siddhant and Karunya were my co-authors on this project. We said, okay, let's put down a list of recommendations. We then tied up with the Sports Law and Policy Center, who have a history of publishing documents which are intended to be for the benefit of the sport. And therefore, they encouraged us to go a little deeper to widen the scope of this kind of a project and to make it a much larger document. And so that's exactly what happened. What we discovered was, you know, if you want to effect change, first you have to understand the lay of the land. First, you have to know what the ground realities are. And there was no cohesive research on women's cricket in India, despite it being such a big sport. I would say that after men's cricket, women's cricket is probably the biggest sport, definitely the biggest team sport, definitely the most popular sport in the country. So if the number two sport in the country doesn't have any kind of research to establish a baseline. So that's the project we decided to take up at the start. If I can share my screen here, I will just give you a glimpse of the Equal Hue project and the report that we published. So this is the final product, the report that we published. I won't go through it in detail. It's as a research paper, it's meant to be a very in-depth document. It's 100 pages, 15,000 words long. But we were very mindful that it shouldn't be just the outsider perspective. And to understand what the community was saying, we conducted a survey with 350 plus cricketers who were already playing for their state. And that survey threw up some fairly interesting results, which I'd like to draw your attention to. So if I'm going to look at the report, I'm going to look at a few sections of it, particularly the sections in our survey where we decided to just put our ear to the ground and see what the players are saying. And some of the results which we knew instinctively, but we wanted to get really down on paper, were quite surprising. I'm sure all of you will have connections with cricket at some point. I'm sure all the gents here will have deeper connections with cricket than the ladies, because that's the way the sport has been structured in our country. And I'm sure those connections will start with your school cricket days. Unfortunately, that's not the case for women. In the survey that we conducted, we asked them that, have you played women's cricket in school where you have a fully girls team? And 60% of them said no. And let's keep in mind that these are girls who have reached the state level, despite not being able to have these opportunities. So they're basically girls who are in a good environment and got to the state level. If you extrapolate to what the grassroots looks like, it gives a very clear idea that there is a huge gap in the Indian cricket ecosystem at the inter-school level. Something else that was a part of what we examined was the social barriers to the sport. Are there still mindsets which are stopping girls from getting into cricket? And these two questions address that. Has anyone in your immediate family ever told you not to play cricket? So these are girls who reach the state level, but still 20% of them had an immediate family member discouraging them from playing cricket because they were girls. If we take that question to the extended family, it went up to 33%. So once again, these are players who have reached the state level. The barriers for players who aren't reaching those levels are even tougher, even deeper. That was something that really stood out from this report. So this was almost the first phase of the Equal Hue project. The project is themed on equality, thus the name, equality between men's and women's cricket. But at the same time, we are very aware that you can't just copy-paste solutions from men's cricket or copy-paste an approach that has worked in men's cricket into a women's cricket program. It is very much equal but different is one of the themes that we have examined in the report. And I'll just take the opportunity to share the report here with everyone in the chat box. And you can go through it at your leisure. It is free to download and freely available for everyone. So if anyone wants to have a look at it, wants to share it ahead, feel free, absolutely. So then the Equal Hue project started thinking. Now we've identified so many areas where we need to really, where work needs to be done, not necessarily by us, because this is a report aimed at all the stakeholders in the ecosystem, not simply the BCCI, not to just lay blame at their door. It's also the players who are stakeholders. It's also the broadcasters who are stakeholders. It's also everyone in this room or the audience who are stakeholders and people in my community, in the media, who are very important stakeholders. So we started thinking about what can we do to really fill some of these gaps that exist. One of the gaps that we certainly saw existing was a lack of knowledge about pathways. Like, for example, if you're a young boy wanting to play cricket for India, you know very clearly that, you know, you get into your club and from there you play inter-club matches, you get selected for your district, from there you can perform well and play for your state and so on. But for girls, they don't even know where their academy, local academy is. Will that academy take women? After they play in an academy, are there women's teams for them to play inter-club matches? When are district selections conducted? There was just a shocking lack of information available for on this point. So in order to fill some of those gaps, we created the Equal Hue website. And once again, I'll share the link with you soon. But something that we've recently launched on the Equal Hue website is what we're calling a guide for girls. So the Equal Hue project team actually sat down, made phone calls and collated information for every state in the country to find out what the pathway is for girls cricket there and put it all together in one central location called Guide for Girls. And this includes answering a bunch of very commonly asked questions like, how to manage cricket versus studies? What kind of gear do you need to play leather ball cricket and how much does that cost? Even tackling questions like how to play cricket along with your periods. These are the kind of questions that we have looked to solve. And like I said, the Equal Hue project, my colleagues in the team worked very hard to create a database for each and every state in India. So any young girl from anywhere in the country can come here to the Equal Hue website and, for example, just click on Chhattisgarh to find out what the situation is in Chhattisgarh. And our team has put together a where to start guide, what kind of cities have the most women's cricket activity, what the contact details of the district association are, at what levels is cricket conducted in those district and state associations, what facilities exist, which are the commonly used venues, what are the phone numbers that you can call to get more information, and whether school cricket, college cricket exists, which are the academies that really provide you the support. So this is one aspect of the Equal Hue project, which we realized this is something that we can do, that this is a gap that we can fill, and this is something that we took a lot of pleasure in being able to fill. We understand that this is currently existing in English, whereas the entire country exists in many languages. And part of the project will be really to translate all these resources and make them more accessible, maybe in video form, because that's how most people consume content nowadays. I'm also going to share the Equal Hue website. So if anyone wants to check out our the page that I just shared, you can just log into the website and check there. And recently as the weekend before this, at the symposium that we had, which was themed around Equal Hue, where we had a number of panel discussions, we also launched an audiobook for girls, an audiobook for children, boys and girls, featuring a women's cricketer as the hero. So we have an audiobook where a young girl is picking up a book written about Mithali Raj. And now she dreams about being Mithali Raj, because we realized that in this particular segment of children's literature, there aren't enough female role models. Forget female cricket role models. There's plenty of books about, how to be maybe Abdul Kalam, or how to be a Sachin Tendulkar for sure. But no one's talking about some of the incredible female role models that our country has produced in the likes of Mithali Raj, Jhulan Goswami. These are cricketers these are just people who are real role models for young girls. And it was a wonderful opportunity, we thought, to introduce these characters in the form of storybook for both boys and girls. And because it's very clear to us that the next generation, it's not just the girls of the next generation, it's also the boys of the next generation who need to grow up where men's and women's cricket stand on an equal footing in a world where it's totally normal for a boy to be playing cricket and a girl to be playing cricket on the streets, in an academy, or for India. Next steps for the Equal Hue project. One more area which we have identified as a huge hole in the Indian cricket ecosystem is the lack of an under 16 tournament. And we are actually piloting a project where we can see if we can fill that gap on a much larger scale. So this is a much larger project than we've ever attempted before. If we can create a national under 16 competition and intercity competition to complement the under 19 and under 23 and senior age groups that already exist for women's cricket, because this is and to give an example of the talent that is out there, everyone must have recently heard of the name of Shefali Verma. Shefali Verma made her debut for India at the age of 15. So there is certainly 15-year-old talented players out there waiting to be discovered and supported by a tournament like this. Smriti Mandana is a player that I'm sure a lot of you will be familiar with. And she made her debut for India at the age of 17. So on one hand, we're seeing that, you have these teenage superstars emerging. Jemima Rodrigues from Bombay is another name that I'm sure you're familiar with. Again, made her debut at the age of 17. At the age of 16, smashed a double century in a 50-over game. Only the second woman to do that. So there is so much of this teenage talent waiting to really erupt, and they don't have the infrastructure that they need. One option is to wait for that infrastructure to be created by the people in charge. The other option is to step up and try and do what we can ourselves, and that's what we're trying to do with the Equal Hue project. I think that's given everyone a fair overview, and I'm happy to take questions now.
Thank you, Ms. Pradhan. Now, before we take questions from everyone else, I'm sure they would like to know a little bit about you. How did you get into cricket? What motivated you? And what was your aha moment that cricket is your path ahead,
My parents describe me and remember me as always someone who is, throwing something around as a small toddler, or picking up like a plastic bottle and swinging around like a bat. Probably because as someone born in the late 80s, I grew up with cricket on TV. Suddenly cable TV had started, and suddenly Sachin Tendulkar was on everyone's screens. And that probably was my early influence. But I was always into sports. I was always an athletic child. And I had started playing cricket. I was playing a number of sports besides that. But then I really found a concrete dream of wanting to open the bowling for India when I saw Jhulan Goswami bowl. So Jhulan Goswami, like everyone would know, is the highest wicket taker in women's ODI cricket. She's the only woman who has 200 plus ODI wickets. She started her career in the year 2000 as a 19-year-old. She's now 38, 39, and still going, still one of India's best players, aiming for that World Cup next year. And watching her bowl in her debut series, because it was one of the rare series which was broadcast by Doordarshan, and I just saw that image of her rushing in and knocking over stumps, and that fast bowler captivated my imagination and said, I was already playing cricket, but then that dream became very concrete that I want to open the bowling with Jhulan Goswami. That's when I really decided that I want to play cricket for India.
Great. And take us through the moment when you actually were handed your India cap.
There's actually two moments I remember. Because I started my cricket before the BCCI came into the picture. Cricket used to be administered by the Women's Cricket Association of India, which was the amateur body which was handling women's cricket until then. And then 2005, the BCCI took over. But that body was at the time doing a very good job, and they were sending a team to Pakistan to play a tournament. So this was an India under 21 team. And it so happened that the kit was being manufactured in Pune, where I live. And I got to go to the shop, and I got to see the India cap sitting there, and they had done a lovely job of embroidering our names. In fact, I have that cap here. They did a lovely job of embroidering our names on those caps. And this is the Women's Cricket Association of India cap, which was the first India cap that I earned for that tour to Pakistan. And then going ahead under the BCCI, I made my debut in 2008. And there is this very Christmas kind of feeling where you finally get a box where all your kit is, and you can unpack it, and you see your name on the back of that shirt in the India colors. And it's an amazing feeling. And I put those clothes on, and I didn't take them off for a fair few hours, even in the hotel room.
Great. And what has been your favorite performance so far?
This is actually a domestic game. I played all my cricket for Maharashtra, and to give everyone context on the domestic scene, the Indian Railways is the toughest team to beat. Many courtesies to Dinah Adelji and the pioneering efforts that she put in building up the Indian Railways as a source of employment for women's cricketers. And she was the first ever women cricketer to be employed by Railways, and she's now built up a legacy of a team that's so hard to beat. They're almost unbeatable on the domestic circuit because they're the only employers. So all the talent is basically attracted by them eventually by the lure of permanent jobs. So we were playing Maharashtra against Railways in a T20 match, and it was a fairly tight game which we managed to tie. Now, because it was tied, it went into a super over. In a super over, on the other side and playing for Railways was Harmanpreet Kaur. Harmanpreet Kaur is a fantastic player of spin. So we knew that she will smash it if we have spinners. So I was the one as a fast bowler who was given the responsibility. I said, okay, I'll bowl this over. And my job was made easy by our batters. One of those batters was Smriti Mandana, my teammate. And she helped us score almost 20 runs in that super over. And then I had to come out and defend that score. And knowing that Harmanpreet Kaur is very strong on her stumps and swinging onto the leg sides, I went with a plan of wide Yorkers and was able to get her out. Then brought Mithali Raj and Poonam Raut to the crease. But still, we had enough runs on the board to win and defeated Railways for the first time in our history. And for the first time in probably 4 or 5 years that they had been beaten in a match at all on domestic level. So that is one of my favorite memories.
Fantastic, fantastic. You really faced some good adversaries in that particular match.
Yeah.
What are the challenges you have faced so far? I mean, during your cricketing career, did you face any challenges?
Yes, there was. Thinking back now, there was plenty of barriers, you could say. For example, there was one game where many a times I was playing as the only girl in a boys' team. And most 90% of the boys had no problem with that kind of an arrangement of those kind of games. But there was this one particular boys team who said, we won't play against a girl. And they absolutely refused to play. And it's not the kind of moment you like, you know, because, I mean, the rest of the boys, they didn't really have any leadership. There wasn't any coach there really to take a call on what to do. So I sat out of that game. And they played, they went ahead and played. And it was a terrible feeling to sit out simply because, you know, some other team had decided that because you're a girl, you're not good enough to play with us. And this is after I had played for India. So ability wasn't a question. which goes to show some of the mindsets that we have still in our country. The fact is, it's a deeply patriarchal country, and therefore for women to come up, there are these different barriers. I've been lucky enough that I've had not faced so many of these barriers as so many other women will. I had an extremely supportive family. Financially, they supported me in terms of whatever I needed in terms of kit. But these moments stick with you, where you're told you're not allowed simply because you're a girl. And that happens at various levels for people who are not as fortunate as me. And that is something that we're hoping to change through the Equal You Project.
You've seen that kind of an attitude changing in the last 10 years, 12 years?
Yes. Especially, I mean, nothing changes it better than visibility. Because when you very clearly see that, yes, this is completely normal. In fact, it's fantastic that women are able to do these things. I'm sure your WhatsApp groups must have featured that amazing catch by Harleen Deol in the last few days. So when you see that, wow, women are doing these kind of things, that is one of the best ways to break down those barriers. And we've had a few moments like that India getting to the 2017 World Cup final, India getting to the final of the 2020 T20 World Cup, first time finalist in a T20 World Cup. And now I think that catch for Harleen Deol, where everyone from Chris Gayle to Narendra Modi is talking about it. So that visibility is one of the best ways to change these kind of things. And luckily, we're in the internet generation. And this is one of the ways to use the internet positively, I think.
Okay, I'll just take a couple of questions, and then I'll leave it open to the others so that they also get a chance to ask you. Three things you would, positive things you want to see changing in women's cricket.
A women's IPL. a proper women's IPL. To give context, I mean, right now, what we have is technically called a women's T20 challenge, and they're exhibition matches between these made-up teams, your Trailblazers, Supernovas, Velocity. What I would love to see is a Mumbai Indians women's squad with Smriti Mandana opening the batting. I'd love to see Kolkata Knight Riders with Jhulan Goswami storming in, or Kings 11 Punjab, or Queens 11 Punjab with Shafali Verma from Rohtak. Wow, that would be something amazing.
And finally, a word of advice for budding cricketers, young boys and girls.
One advice that was really important for me growing up, and maybe more important and applicable to girls, is if you don't ask, you won't get. There is always this little bit of hesitancy asking for things that, you know, almost coming from the question of, do I deserve it? Am I worth it? So I will say to the young girls especially, but even the boys, that if you don't ask, you won't get. So if you want to go ahead in life and you want to make a career in this, have the courage to ask whatever it is that you want to ask.
Thank you so much, Ms. Pradhan. Now, I'll have the members asking questions, and President Sharnaz Vakil will take over from it. Thank you so much.
Sharnaz, you're on mute.
Really interesting to see how at every level women have to fight to get, you know, even simple way forward. Something like a cricket team, it's unbelievable when we hear what you had to say. So now let's open it up to is Mudit around? He's the one who's promised to ask.
Yes, I'm ready. Yes, President Sharnaz. Thank you, Snehal. That was very, very inspiring. And, you know, like Abu Ben Adam, may your tribe increase. My question is, do you think cricket and other women's sports can get popularized by an IPL type of format, which is, you know, well suited to all sports with a short attention spans? Do you think IPL will be there? And that catch that you talked about, I think that's the best catch I've ever seen in cricket. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you. I 100% believe that a women's IPL will take women's cricket to new heights. It's simply the fact that A, you have a highly visible tournament because it's broadcast. B, you have a high quality tournament because you have the Indian stars boosted by the international stars. Now, I hear a lot of arguments saying that we don't have the depth for a women's IPL. There isn't enough quality in our domestic cricket. And I say start with four teams. Because even when the men's IPL started, there was conversations about, you know, domestic cricket isn't good enough. It's only the international players doing everything. Start with four teams. But the longer we delay that, the more we're pushing, holding our own girls back. So I 100% think the women's IPL will give our players, especially the domestic players who aren't in the international teams right now, the exposure that they need, that when they reach the international level, they are ready-made match winners. And then we will see more and more Shefali Vermas and more people who are ready to win a World Cup for India. And that big goal can really change everything. And sorry, the second question about that catch, it is fantastic. It was like probably the first time I've seen that kind of a catch in women's cricket. And it comes back to investments made in the game. For example, full-time contracts, professional contracts were introduced in women's cricket in 2015. India was the last country among the top eight countries to introduce professional contracts for our women's cricketers. What that means is Harleen Deol, who is now in the Indian team, doesn't need a railway job like me. I was with Western Railway and I had to balance half my time in an office and half my time playing cricket, because I needed the security of that railway job. Harleen Deol now has a contract which earns her 30 lakhs a year. And if she keeps investing even 10 lakhs into her training and gets physically strong enough to take those kind of catches, the more and more investment we make in our women's cricketers, the more we're going to see those kind of catches. They'll become normal.
Thank you. We have a question from Dhruv Shetty, RC Jai Hind.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dhruv Shetty. Ma'am, I had a question to you. Is do you think there is a need of a mixed match of men's and women's so that there would be a sign of equality or something like that?
This is an interesting conversation that we keep having when we're having the equality conversation. And I'll come back to one of the themes that we identified in our report, that is different but equal. So a short answer, maybe no. If you have it one-off as, you know, a publicity match or an exhibition match, okay, fine. But do we want mixed doubles like we have in tennis and badminton in cricket? No, I don't think so. The men's and the women's games are different enough to be appreciated as different sports. For example, if in the men's sport, you can appreciate that on certain surfaces, 120 is a good score, and on certain surfaces, 180 is a good score. Similarly, when you're looking at women's cricket, don't look at it with the same lens of men's cricket. Like, you know, they're not scoring even 180 runs in 20 overs. They're not able to bat. Think of it with a different perspective, that 160 is a really good score. For example, England scored 177 against India in that first game. But on the other hand, India defended a score of 140 and in an extremely exciting match. So I think, yes, there is a little bit of publicity value to this mixed gender kind of a match. But in the long run, women's cricket and men's cricket can and should be appreciated as different sports with the same cricket that we love.
Thank you, ma'am.
From Nivriti Chang, RC Jai Hind.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I am Nivriti Chang from RC Jai Hind. I wanted to ask you a few questions. First one is, what inspired you to start your own YouTube channel? And the second question is, who was your coach and your guide during your early years of training? Thank you.
Thank you for those questions. The YouTube channel story is very interesting. And I don't know how many people here will relate, but I like I said, grew up in the 90s and I watched these cartoons as a kid. Cartoon Network and all those things had just come to India, and some of these cartoons coming in from abroad, one of them was Pokemon, and I love this little cartoon called Pokemon. And maybe many of your kids would have been fascinated by a particular game that erupted 5 years back called Pokemon Go. I was one of those people fascinated by Pokemon Go, and I decided, okay, let's find out how to play this game. So I went on YouTube and found this particular YouTube channel, which was teaching how to play Pokemon Go in a style that I really loved and I connected with. And I thought, hello, if he's teaching how to play Pokemon Go on YouTube, why don't I teach how to play cricket on YouTube? And that's the inspiration behind my YouTube channel. And then I started experimenting really with the YouTube format. And I discovered, okay, there's an audience here. people started watching my videos, and then I started to take it seriously and look at it as a way that I can cross borders and reach people with good quality coaching that that is not possible physically, because there aren't enough academies, there aren't enough good quality coaches. Like, for example, along with my YouTube channel, for those who want to learn more deeply with me, I have an online coaching program. So I give them exactly what they should be doing. They can do it at home, and they have access to international quality guidance, which is not possible no matter which academy they go to. So I think that's the power of the internet. And that's why, I mean, YouTube is one of my favorite platforms. And as far as the second question and a guide for me, one person really was my state team captain, Amrita Shinde. And she was someone who really inspired a whole batch of us to take our game to the next level, because she had played for India. She had seen what high level cricket is like. And she was then helping to lift our entire batch in that way. And her own example was really inspiring. So she's been the biggest mentor through my playing days.
Thank you, Snehal. Any more questions? Parat?
Yes. Thank you, Snehal. My question is, just tell us, what is BCCI doing for women's cricket? What kind of initiatives is BCCI taking for, you know, we're such a powerful cricket body, you see, globally, and we have a great, huge, very, very, what you can say, powerful voice there. You know, at the ICC level today also, you know the prize money difference of what women's cricket is getting vis-a-vis men. You know, 19 million US for 2019 for men and 5.5 for women. There's a huge disparity. But just initiative that BCCI has taken to promote women's cricket and building the, so to say, you know, next generation of cricketers for women in India.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a really good question. And one thing BCCI has done well is in terms of the matches that they do conduct, they're conducted well. They're conducted to the same standard that men's domestic matches are conducted, with a high quality of umpiring, video analysis and video recording of each match, good quality stay, good quality grounds, good quality travel. So all the players are traveling by air. 2 years ago, match fees for domestic cricketers were increased. So match fees went from 2,500 per match to 12,500 per match, which was a major increase, a much needed increase. But so there's a lot of things which are going right, but I would definitely say that the BCCI is not doing enough. For example, match fees for men who play domestic cricket are in the range of 35,000 per day. So it's, and for example, if you look at the state of the women's team in the pandemic, and where you had the men's IPL, the men's tour to Australia, England coming to India and playing a series in Ahmedabad and Pune, whereas the women's team didn't play any international cricket for an entire year. So I would say the BCCI needs to do more. And there is certainly potential to be exploited if they do more.
Thank you, Snehal. Thank you.
Thank you. So if there are any more questions, I think we've had all the questions. Thank you. Akshay, if you could please give us a vote of thanks.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Ms. Pradhan, for such a wonderful afternoon and such an enlightening talk. I can say that there are many cricketers who play for themselves and for their teams, but you have certainly played for your country by making sure that women really start playing the game after you. And I can assure you that when we see the women's IPL and when we see the women's team bringing the World Cup home, our Rotarians will smile and think of you, because we know, we will remember your contribution to this feat. So thank you very much for spending the afternoon with us. And as a token of our appreciation, we will plant 10 fruit-bearing trees at Nilmati Dandwal Gram Panchayat, Maharashtra, in your name. And the said certificate will be sent to you shortly.